I'm going to start recording right now. And
let me ask you, how's the reception from my end? Am I clear?
You sound perfect. You sound perfect.
Great.
So my goal is to have you in my life. So I will be, we're rolling, by the way.
Let's do it, honey.
Okay. Let's go for it. I need you in my life.
How can we do this? How can we make this happen, and still not piss off any of our relatives?
All right, let me introduce you to my listeners. I can't even believe I'm saying to Phil Hendrie, let me introduce you to my listeners. But I have to, because we have listeners all over the world, and awesome. I want to make a proper introduction. And you're going to have to suffer through this, sir. I apologize. You're just going to have to take it like a man.
All right. Well, I'm driving for coffee, so.
All right, folks, this is heaven for me. Phil Hendrie is on the show. He is one of the most important comedic minds of any generation. And here's what you need to do. Go to philhendrieshow.com and sign up for his monthly pass. I think it's like $8. He'll tell us in a second. I'm not sure. Maybe it's $8 a month. I'm telling you, this is the deal of a lifetime. I just signed up for it. Someone has gone and archived all of Phil Hendrie's radio shows. I signed up for it last night. I can kick myself. I didn't know you could do this. And I started listening to some old episodes of the Phil Hendrie show last night. There are 30,000 hours of Phil Hendrie with no commercials. This cannot be good. This is not good for somebody like me. I have an addictive personality. I barely slept last night. Let me tell you how important Phil Hendrie is. My son, my oldest son, is in Germany right now. He just graduated from college, and he is off studying Karl Marx and speaking German in Berlin. Living the life. And we FaceTimed, and he said, why do you have dark circles under your eyes? I said, because Phil Hendrie is on the show, and I was up all last night listening to his archives. And my 23-year-old son, when I told him that I was about to talk to Phil Hendrie, I might as well have said to him, somebody has combined Noam Chomsky and Barack Obama, and I'm about to speak to this mutant of Noam Chomsky and Barack Obama and Robin Williams. He could not believe it. And he just graduated from college. My kids grew up listening to Phil Hendrie in Los Angeles. We timed errands so we could listen to Phil Hendrie. I have bootleg tapes of Phil Hendrie in storage. When my wife threw me out of the house, I have tapes of Phil Hendrie. And it turns out I don't need them, because I just signed up for the philhendrieshow.com. And Phil,
how you doing,
good.
David?
They are better.
I guess I know how you're doing. You're tired. You got dark circles. You're in trouble.
Here's what I want to do, because we've never met and we've never talked. I want to gush a little and get people to sign up for philhendrieshow.com, if you don't mind. Can we do that?
That's a beautiful thing. I appreciate that very much. Thank you.
Okay. So I may cover some ground with you that is banal, stuff you've already been through.
Mm-hmm.
And I apologize for it. But some people just have no idea how brilliant you are. So who curated the 30,000 hours? How did you do that?
Well, most of the people that don't know how brilliant I am are radio executives. But anyway, that stuff came to us in a big lump of material from Clear Channel, passing the ownership of the material to us. So what we did then is I had a pretty smart guy, Brian Blicklick, who was our administrator, and basically it was already chronological. So all we had to do was migrate the material from their platform over to ours, make sure that no links were broken. And that was in 2006, David. And from 2006 to today, 10 years, we have gradually refined the logs. We've refined the media, gone from MP3s to video as well. We've had three or four different designs of the website. So we've improved as we go. One of the things I've learned about websites is it's always constantly, you know, the technology's changing. Everything's changing, so you're always improving it. But and then we add to it with the current little hour-long podcast that I do today, which is very different from on the radio show because we're not on the radio anymore. So it's just basically a straight character presentation.
The great thing about your website is you introduce all the characters and you explain where they come from and how they evolved, where Bobby Dooley came from and Ted Bell. And these voices just, they, like my son.
That was an idea that my present web guy, Shane Martin, had. He said, let's do pictures of these people because really it's about you and them. And let's have them in sort of a carousel of characters, and because they're just as real. And I don't mean to the listeners; I mean to me, you know. And that's how bad it's gotten. But I talk to them off the air. that was a great idea, and that's only about a month or so old because the new design of our site. If you became a member last night, David, I think I heard you say, you're entering a website that's only a month old in terms of the design.
I like it, and
the other thing is, and I don't want to get too technical, but I don't think anybody's tried this before, man. I don't think anybody has a radio repository or an audio comedy repository that's so large. I really would say with confidence that it's probably the largest in the world, because most radio guys toss a 2-minute bit in there to say, here's our show today, and you know, we interviewed so and so, and then the rest of it is just whatever. So we're learning as we go, and it's such an enormous amount of material that I thought for a while there we were going to have to hire somebody like the New York Public Library to know how to actually move it, and because there's not a lot of people, but we did find some people who could do it, and so there it is. And we're always fixing stuff and correcting stuff, and you know, I had a guy today on Twitter. Hey, man, I signed up for a BSP. What happened to episode 609? Regine Chappelle gets the shit kicked out of me and all this stuff. I'm like, what the hell are you talking about, man? It is, God damn it, you know, to these cats, it's the most important thing going. So I get on the horn to my web people. I go, what happened to episode 609? The dude can't find it. Oh, yeah. The Clay said the code is wrong, man. It didn't show up because the code's wrong from the old site to the new site. We just corrected the code, so it's there now. Just stuff like that, which... to you and I is a technical fix. To a listener or to anybody that loves this, your work or my work, David, they're going to commit Harry Carey. I mean, they're going to you're stealing from them somehow. So,
well, let me tell you about PhilHendrieShow.com because I have these bootleg tapes. I have the Reverend hooking a homosexual's genitalia up to a car battery.
Oh my God.
Curing homosexuality. And I would play this to all my friends over the years, and it always held up. But I had no idea if your stuff would, what the shelf life was. It's funnier now than the first time I heard it. I think you're the only radio personality ever in the history of the medium, unless you go back to like Jack Benny. Because he still holds up. Your stuff holds up. And I cannot believe that you can go to PhilHendrieShow.com, pay, I don't know, $8. I don't know what it is. I don't care. It was one
I think
of
it's like, I think it's $9 or something like that.
Okay,
yeah.
$9. I cannot believe that for $9 a month, I have access to 30,000 hours commercial-free. Let me explain to the listeners what you invented, how profound it was, and why people like Judd Apatow, Seth MacFarlane, Rick Overton worship you. These people, I mean, you're operating at a level, there's comedy, and then there's Phil Hendrie. One of the things you stumbled upon something that... It is phenomenal. You do a a regular talk show. You sound like a normal human being, and then you would have a guest on the show who would be the descendant of plantation owners, and he would insist that if we're going to give reparations to African Americans, the slave owners, the children of the descendants of slave owners, are entitled to reparations because of all the lost labor. And you would treat
the lost income.
And you would, but nobody knew other than the listeners on the in the big markets on, in Los Angeles, we were in on the joke. We knew that you were the voice of the descendant of the slaveholders. But we also knew that your show was being syndicated to backwater towns. And that's
well, you know, I gotta interrupt you there though, because the really the people that we got that we hooked on the line were from a lot of them were from L.A. and from the bigger cities.
Really,
because you know, big cities have all kinds of people. Yeah, and I remember a sales guy at KFI saying to me when I first walked into the sales meeting there, he said, "Well, you might have been successful in places like Minneapolis, but this is L.A." And within 2 weeks, you know, I proved him wrong, because we were not syndicated right away. We were local until 1999, and that's when we became national.
So these were, wow.
Yeah, all kinds of people. And people who would openly admit to me, David, now look, I'm a member of Mensa, so don't even mess with me, okay? And that's how the call would start, you know? Yeah, I have a degree in psychology and everything, so you can just forget your little funny game. You know, the next thing you know, this guy's you still want to say to the guy, "Is that right? Great." Well, you're talking to a made-up voice, sir. It's not really a psychiatrist from I would say, L.A. Any large city is just there's just more of everybody, including kind of the dummies, including sort of the dummies and maybe not quite as unsophisticated in terms of city life and that kind of thing. But when it comes to media, especially the way we were using it in a whole new way, like you were saying, because everybody was taking talk radio so seriously in the 90s, it was reaching its penultimate moment of gravity. Everything was serious. And, Alan Berg, called it the campfire, America's campfire, until it had to be. It was ripe for, slamming, and that's what we did. But I interrupted you. But I wanted to kind of.
Yeah, I was always. Well, I had heard somebody told me that Laurie Metcalf, the great actress from Steppenwolf and from Roseanne, that she was one of the fake callers early on. Is that true?
No. I would say that no, she was never on the show that way. But Laurie was a friend from almost from the minute I got to L.A. She got in touch with me and really enjoyed the show, and I had the good fortune of hanging out with her. Glenn Headley was another one who was there, and
from the Eagles. From the Eagles.
Glenn, no, Glenn Headley. I'm not talking about that one. I'm talking about the beautiful redheaded actress who was in Dick Tracy. Things you get to do in Denver. You know Glenn Headley? Redhead. And then Jeff Altman.
Uh-huh.
Ross Schaefer. Guys like that.
Oh, wow.
Which was I had no idea. I mean, I had no idea that was. I grew up in Los Angeles, but when I came here, my whole feeling was, this is going to be cool to be on the air in my hometown because I know where things are. That was the big perk for me. I know where this freeway is and this town is. I wasn't prepared for the Hollywood thing, which, there you go. I was born and raised here, and I was kind of a hick when it came to that. But
being seduced by people who would say things. Well, you have done a lot of acting jobs. You're in Futurama, and you've been in movies that Judd Apatow directed, and you were in a sitcom. You played a teacher on a sitcom, right?
And it was called Teachers.
Right.
And I've even, but I never really thought about anything like that until I, A, got here, and B, realized that the radio world was a very limited thing. There was a ceiling that I was bumping up against that, these cats realized that they had to sell the show. They had to affiliate the show. That sounds like a normal thing, you and I, but in radio, they don't want to do that too much work like that. they really want a turnkey operation, and they wanted their political talk. And my show, while it sounded like a talk show, was really just a comedy show, and it should have been on its own almost format, like personality talk as opposed to a news talk. Mm-hmm. So it was like selling T-shirts. It was like selling really good tie-dye T-shirts in a Cadillac showroom, you know. Or maybe it's the other way around. Maybe I was selling Cadillacs in a tie-dye T-shirt showroom. You know? People would come in and say, oh, wow, that's a really cool Cadillac you got there. You want to buy one? Well, no, because I came in here to get a T-shirt, you know. So what happened instead was good people like yourself, David, and other people found us piecemeal, and that's why the website works. Because now it's a place to go to and say, okay, here is where we can go, and we understand it, and we listen to it, and this is the library of that act, you know, and we don't have to sit there and wade through all of the noise of a talk radio station, which is pretty daunting, you know.
There are two people who paralyzed me in my car. One was Howard. I would sit and listen to Howard. But I outgrew Howard. There comes a point when you start getting laid and you go, all right, I'm done with Howard.
Hey, and David, can I ask you, do you mind if I order some coffee?
I would love to hear it. Listening.
I'm at the Starbucks drive-thru.
Okay.
And go ahead, but when you hear me say something into
I want to hear you order coffee. This is...
Can I get two Cascara Venti lattes with non-fat milk? Yes.
Okay, Venti Cascara lattes with non-fat milk. Anything else for you today?
That's it. Thank you.
All right. So, to my listeners who have never heard of you, and this is really important, listening to that, wondering, is that really the voice of the girl behind the cash register? Because that's your show. That's one of the things you've done, is where you trick the listener into thinking that the other voices you hear are real. Yeah.
Yeah. That's I loved radio since the day I was born, I think. And I really fell in love with a cross country trip to Canada with my parents to see my cousins and my aunt and my uncle. My parents moved to California in the late 40s from Toronto. But during that trip, and it seemed like I would be the only one awake other than my dad as he was driving across the desert, he had the radio on, and I would hear these stations fade in and fade out. I would hear these lone voices providing this amazing entertainment. There's music. He's talking about the weather. He's talking about the city he's in. He sounded, first of all, sound like a nice guy. And I thought, man, I don't think I thought I want to do that for a living, but I sure as hell thought, this is a really cool thing that this guy's doing, you know, and... So I think from that point forward, I was always thinking of ways to further manipulate it. I mean, isn't that what it's about? No matter what our art is, how can we, where can we go with it, you know? Mm-hmm. Until it got to the point where satire, I loved humor so much, satire, to satirize it was the next logical step. Not just to do it, but to blow it up a little bit. Hi. Thank you. Just because you love it, not because you hate it. You love it.
Right.
Although I have to tell you, I don't love talk radio. I hate talk radio, but I don't hate radio.
Mm-hmm. Well, you hate what it's become, because I think in this country, they're afraid of radio. Radio is pre-literate. Radio is the most dangerous thing around. It gets in your head, and... it can convince you to do horrible things. In Rwanda, they couldn't have had the genocide in Rwanda without radio. It was...
Wow.
That they told... There was a morning shock jock. The generals would get on the radio, not the television, because they'd get in the head of the Hutus and tell them to start massacring the Tutsis, or whatever they were called. I don't mean to be glib.
Oh, my God.
You
I had no idea. I had no idea.
And that's why that's why there's so much corporate control in America because of radio. Because if people are allowed to say what they want to say, we could have a real democracy here. I was listening to you last night after 9/11. I said, let me just see what happened, how he handled 9/11.
Yeah.
Ted Bell, who owns the steakhouse. And
yeah, that's a Beverly Hills.
Yeah, and he is a real entrepreneur, as you always say. He was the one who was the first. It was the first steakhouse to put aluminum foil around a baked potato.
Right, right. Aluminum foil. And also, I believe he was the first one to have an actual serrated steak knife as opposed to just a butter knife, you know.
Mm-hmm. I remember taking my kids to the Colburn Music School.
Mm-hmm.
And we're driving, you know, that's expensive stuff to take your kid to music school. And Ted Bell was on, and Ted Bell Steakhouse was being, people were protesting because Ted Bell didn't want handicapped people sitting in the front banquets. I don't know if you remember this, but you would come.
What do we call that in a restaurant? I was going to say the foyer. That's not it.
Yeah, but yeah. You had had some kind of thing with the Make-A-Wish Foundation or disabled people. It was a special hour where they could come and eat. But then afterwards, you threw them out because they were they were unappetizing, and you're trying to move steaks there, and people criticize you for.
We did the same thing, David, at a Laker game. In other words, he had these tickets, and they were right next to Jack Nicholson, and he gave me, you know, Phil, I'd like you to, you know, just bring on. I'd like to take a couple of your listeners. Well, we have a charity that let's help out the charity kids. And they turned out to be like bald kids with, chemotherapy. And suddenly Ted, like, freaked out. He's sitting with bald kids. And he's also sitting with, bless their little hearts, developmentally disabled kids. So some of the kids are not watching the game. They're looking up in the air, and they're staring at, and they take the hot dog out of the bun. Ted's saying, no, I can't. I said, what are they doing, man? Well, they're licking the window and putting the bologna on it, and it just doesn't work, you know. He says, I can't do it, man. I can't do it. And there's nothing worse. And you know what? When we prep that, because you learn what the visceral areas are. You can talk about things that are topical, but you need to also be, they have to be visceral. They have to be emotional. Like, I can talk about mowing the lawn. Everybody knows about mowing the lawn, but who cares? But if I talk about children, if I talk about immigrants, if I talk about veterans, there are areas, animals, mm-hmm. And it's certainly children that are disabled, and then you throw in the fact that you're going back on a promise you made. now you're the biggest asshole the world has ever known, and you go there because you go, how do we pull calls? I know how we're gonna pull calls. We gotta go there, and I know how to get us there, but we have to go there. You know.
I remember that this is one of the most vivid memories of raising children. So Colburn School, kids in the back seat, mm-hmm. three kids in the back seat, expensive piano lessons, dance lessons. We're driving down to Colburn School, and this is going on where Ted Bell is kicking handicapped people out of the steakhouse because, you know, he's trying to sell steak and people lose their appetite when they see them. And I park the car. And the radio, and I have my hands on the steering wheel, and nobody's saying anything. And, you know, it's like 4 o'clock, the classes start.
Yeah.
And it's now, you know, and daddy, and I go, no, I think we have to hear this. And they were like a half hour late for their lessons. And we come home, how were the lessons? Well, we were late a half hour. Phil Hendrie, and my wife, to her credit, said, yeah. It was like, this was more important than my kids hear this. It was, yeah.
You bring that up because that's called time spent listening. In radio, that's like gold when you have people sitting in a car to hear the end of a bit. That's gold. And in L.A., our commute time in Los Angeles is somewhere in the neighborhood of an hour. So if you can get a TSL from a radio listener of even 10 minutes a day times five, you know, so that's almost an hour a week. That's an amazing TSL. In New York, it's shorter because people are on subways. The New York TSL, if you can get somebody for 5 minutes a day, believe it or not, the average, the listener to Howard is probably a lot longer than that, but average radio listener in New York is probably only hearing their radio for maybe 5-10 minutes every 2 days, something like that. When you say that to me, or any listener says to me, I stayed in my car, you're like, nah, you give that to a sales guy, and he should be able to take that and go out and sell you a whole lot of airtime.
Oh, now, you crippled
us. What happened to my what happened to my guys? I don't know. I don't have any idea, but, you know.
Oh, you crippled us. I have memories because we were originally from San Francisco, and we would drive up the 101 and the 5, and somebody would sit in the front seat frantically searching for Phil Hendrie, that we would be constantly looking for you. And it was all the difference. It was all the difference. The trip was, if we could get you, then the trip was okay. And if we couldn't find you, we were, we had to talk to one another. It really sucked.
Yeah.
Did you find after 9/11, I was shocked by Ted Bell, and he was complaining about the 300 people dying on 9/11. Sometimes it was 30,000. He was getting the numbers wrong.
The numbers are all wrong.
Yeah. He was complaining that because he's rich, he should be able to have his limo driver pick up his luggage at the carousel. It was as sacrilegious as you could get after 9/11. And at the same time, harmless. What kind of trouble was there, or was there any?
There wasn't any substantial. The trouble you get with bits like that is it's tasteless. Well, there's an argument to be made there, is it or is it not? You know, where you're going to get into trouble is if you endanger. I did one that I regret. I had one day our general manager, David Hall, come on, a character that I did, saying that he had anthrax because he had accidentally sniffed this powder. That is funny, and it's also not too dangerous because anthrax in the powder is sort of static. It's in an envelope. It's sitting someplace. You have to go to it or find it. But I really messed up. A week later, I went on and said he had tuberculosis. And that, thank God, I bailed on that bit within about 10 minutes because I didn't feel right about it, because the next day there was a fair number of phone calls from people pissed off about that. That's a panic thing, and you don't want to do that. And that was a mistake. So, but I would say that was the only one of those that we made.
You're in a bubble, and yet you're not. You know, I'm a stand-up comic. Mm-hmm. I know how I'm doing, if I've crossed a line by the booze. And, you know, when you're doing radio, it's the calls, but the calls aren't an accurate barometer of the audience. The calls are the lunatics who have the time to actually call you.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. And that's something that you really had to educate the entire business to back when we started doing our show. Because we knew that callers represent only about 2% of the audience, or maybe 1, and then the callers that get through on our show represent an even smaller version of that. So we knew that they were not representative. They're there on the stage with me. They're performers. They're just not aware of it. You know? The real audience, That's like when I was a kid. And the real audience is not active either. You know, when I was a kid, my father listened to the radio all the time. But I said to him one day when I got older and I was in the business, I said, Dad, have you ever written a fan letter to a guy? What? You know, why would I do that? You know? Mm-hmm. Well, Dad, I'm not going to write a letter to this jackass. But you like listening to him. Oh, sure. Well, that's really the typical radio listener. They don't really reach out and actively seek out. They just dig it. They listen. It gets them through the day. It gets them through a commute. And so the callers getting outraged did not bother us at all. Unless we knew the bit itself, the material itself, was going to reverberate into the larger audience in a negative way. One thing that happened in L.A. in those days, David, you might remember, there were windows, automobile windows, getting shattered by rocks from slingshots out on the freeway. People were getting their windows shattered from passing cars using slingshots. This only took place over a period of a week. It happened at night, but it was extremely scary. And I did a bit where I had a gangbanger, you know, where I thought, you know, yeah, well, you know, I'm looking for my merit badge right now in slingshot, but later, all this shit. Well, this little girl calls during the commercial break, and my producer says, Joe, he says, you got to talk to this kid. And she's a little 12-year-old. She says, my mom drives home at night from her work, and I want to know if she's okay. And I said, honey, I told her right away what was going on. And generally, what happened to her. She went from this very serious, concerned voice to hysterical laughter within 5 seconds, you know. she couldn't believe, you know. She was laughing her ass off and also very relieved, you know.
Uh-huh.
So that kind of stuff will bother me, and I'll definitely break character and break the so-called fourth wall to let people know. But beyond that, I don't care. Like, I'll give you an example, David, where some people invite it. They invite the insult. To give you an example, I was talking about I have a character named Harvey Wireman. He's an ex-Marine attorney. He's sort of based on F. Lee Bailey. You know, he went through JAG school. The Marines made him an attorney. Now he's an ACL. You guys, you know, he's in Saipan and WW2, so don't give me your bullshit, you know. And anyway, and he's talking about this billboard, this workout billboard. I saw this woman. She was a piece of ass up there. And I want to go to this and that and something else. A guy calls, and he wants to blow Harvey. I don't know what the premise was, but it was something that really offended this man. This guy says, you know that you're talking about that woman. I lost my stepdaughter. She died of cancer just 2 days ago. And Harvey goes, was she a piece of ass? You know? Is that why you're calling? You know? She must have been a piece of ass calling it. Now, we get away with that.
You get away. That's you. That's you.
Yeah, but when I say the audience instinctively knows it's okay what Phil just did there, because that guy was asking for it, you know? He was asking for it.
It really is.
Gives you a certain satisfaction, too. My daughter, she died. She must have been a piece of ass, huh? You know? Oh, dude.
Well, to reduce it down to its essence, it's not to be insulting, it's kind of like a ventriloquist routine. Where you're indemnified, you say these horrible things, and then blame your dummies. Mm-hmm. I mean, but it's much more sophisticated than that.
Well, but you know, the thing is, the audience, like going to a play, the audience will not hold the actor responsible for the horrible things the actor is saying. It's the same thing. If I was just doing a straight talk show, and I was talking like that, as you well know, I'd probably get fired, you know, if I was kept on the air, that people would hate me. But because it's coming through a character, and everybody knows, my audience knows it's me, they're cool with it. You know, like, honestly, you know, here. Or they get the fact, well, he's making a larger point about this, that, or something else. Who knows, you know, but I always felt that if you had to have a higher level of intelligence to kind of get our show, because of what we were doing mechanically, and also what we were doing in terms of content, it's a real satire, which is humor with a point of view, you know. And our point of view I tend to be a liberal, but 9/11 turned me into one of those 9/11 Democrats. I really wanted to go and blow fucking everything up, you know. I wanted to kill everything, so I could use my liberal sensibility to kind of mess with people and say things like, you know, Bobby Dooley's a character. You know, Phil, we have our homeowners association. These American flags, you know, these American flags, they violate our homeowners association. What do you mean they violate? They're too large, you know. They got to put smaller flags up there. I know that my father has a friend who was at Iwo Jima or whatever that was, and they put a flag.
You mean Iwo Jima?
Yes. The first flag they put up at Iwo Jima was smaller than the big one that they finally put up. You know, all of this shit.
I can remember driving down the 101 with my family, and Bobby was complaining about these new neighbors. They're black, but that's okay. and that was your refrain throughout the entire thing. They're black, but that's okay.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah, you know, there's something very psychopathic about that man. You know, you don't trust that woman at all, you know. I had a bit, probably one of the more controversial ones, but people, you know, liked it, was Steve and I are going to Europe this summer, and we're going to go visit Auschwitz. Uh-huh. Yeah, it's really interesting. Have you heard about it? Yes, I have heard about it. You know, I go, Bobby, you realize that millions of people were killed there? Uh-huh, yeah. And we're going to go see that. You know, it's, you know, it's like, she's not quite getting it here, man. You know, uh-huh. She kept talking about, and after that, we're going to go to the Black Forest for a box lunch. You know, some shit like that. And I always love that because, you know, David, I grew up, and Bobby is my mother. You know, I grew up with sort of a psychopathic mother. You know, she... That was my mom. She, and that whole thing that I did with Bobby when people would talk, I'd do this thing of, even almost as if she's not really hearing me. I'm saying, and Mom, the other thing that I did, Yeah, it's kind of like your mother, well, you're telling her that you just won the Nobel Prize. She's looking to see if your pants are right, you know, and if you got the right socks on and your shoes are right and all this shit. So...
The great
that's my mom.
The great thing that I, as I was listening to you last night when I should have been sleeping, it's music. There is music. There is the slow build. It's symphonic. And you know exactly where you are on the clock when you want, you know when to accelerate it. Near the end, you have to get people angry and screaming. And it is, it really is. You're a maestro because you begin to provoke and say things and get the people really angry to the point where it completely breaks down, where people are screaming at each other, and it is the worst.
And it's bizarre. It'll get bizarre, too. The guy, you know, the next thing you know, the guy's talking about traveling extra dimensionally or something. You know, where are you? What are you talking about now? You know, like, this guy, Jason. I have a Korean War veteran character I do named Lloyd Bonafide. I'll tell you something. And he had another veteran called up. Hey, buddy, how you doing? Yeah, I'm fine. Some guy in D.C. You know what we used to do to a guy? And they're talking about a third person there, another character I'm doing. We used to take a guy like that, Vaseline up his ass, take turns, you know? Now the guy, now this guy is like, no, we didn't do that, man. That, you know, that's no. Oh, come on, sure you did, you know. Good Lord, I mean.
I don't want to.
So that's an area. Yeah.
The I guess this is an unfair question because I don't want to peel back the curtain too much. How much preparation and how much of a staff do you have? Do you talk it out with anybody? How much of this is an unfair question, but
well, I mean, look, the curtain's been peeled back for many years now. It really, and I'm going to be very honest with you. People sometimes think, well, you must have a lot of people, and actually, no. I worked with a producer writer for a few years, and I had some really good ones, but I found that I am better at it. I'm better at knowing exactly what the topic is. I know exactly how I want to write it. I had some good ones, but I never had one that was quite as sharp enough as I was. So I wound up really with a bare staff. It was me, and I also produced and wrote. We had an engineer, and we had a film screener. So we had a staff of three toward the end. When we had that thing pumping on all cylinders, and I would say 2005 was the year it was really smoking. That's what we had, and it worked great. I knew exactly, you know, everything kind of came together. I knew exactly what kind of topics. You know, one of the big mistakes we make in talk radio is you grab a newspaper and you look at the headline. And I always used to say to my guys, the only reason why they have a headline there, man, is because they have to have a headline. There may be nothing going on, but they're going to put up some stupid thing like, water bond issue passes. Wow, everybody's talking about the water bond issue then, huh? No, nobody gives a shit, man, but they got to put something there.
Mm-hmm.
So you gotta, those are the days when you gotta kind of sit there and almost telepathically figure out what's the country talking about. I was driving to work one night. It was late January, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, nothing going on, man. I think the Super Bowl had already been played. It was that dead time of year. And I just sat in my car for a few minutes before I went inside. I said, it came to me, people are talking about their jobs right now. They're talking about their jobs, how much they hate them. how much they hate driving to work. And that's, I went upstairs with that as a kernel of what I was going to do on the show, and it was a great hour. I forget what we did with it, but if you looked at the headline that day, it probably would have been some bullshit about who knows what, man, some bill that Congress was passing or something, right. The president, you know, threw up, maybe Bush choked on a fucking carrot or something, I don't know, but...
And in terms of prep, work, if you don't mind my asking you, is it conceivable
that
some of these shows you just show up at the studio and are totally unprepared with just the germ?
No, that can happen, but a couple of things have to be happening to make that happen. For instance, one night I was on the air at WCCO in Minneapolis. I went downstairs for a cigarette. It was the last news break of the night. It's 1 o'clock in the morning. I get off the air too, so I got an hour, and I don't like what I got planned. And all of a sudden, I forget what it was, but something popped into my head. Maybe it was something we've been talking about, unrelated during the hour. Something popped into my head, and in that 5-minute period, I formulated exactly what the opening would be, how I'd roll it out, and where I would take it. And it was funny. It was cracking me up. And that, I can tell you, happened in, you know, over the course of the 16 years that I did that show on radio, maybe 2 or 3 times. So you got to work, you know, like everything else in this world, you have to work. And some days it's easier than others. Gary Owens was you remember a disc jockey named Gary Owens?
From Laughing, yes.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. Gary used to say, for every hour you're on the air, that's how many hours you should prep. So if you do a 3-hour show, you should prep for 3 hours. And I did that religiously for many years.
Wow.
After all, it was Gary Owens. And I found out that, well, that worked for Gary Owens. You know, that didn't mm-hmm. work for Phil Hendrie. Because I would spend 3 hours worrying about shit, man. I used to do that, you know.
How do you...
I find that an hour and a half for me is plenty.
How do you know if the show is good or bad? How do you measure the quality?
If I'm entertained, I have to really go with that, because, you know, I've had hours where I've had lots of calls, and they all seemed like they were good calls, but they didn't really crack me up. They all just kind of one after the other. I'm sure that we had hours and even whole shows toward the end of my run on live radio where I had a whole lot of people that kind of knew who I was and kind of got what this thing was, but maybe I was being serious, maybe I wasn't. So they were very cautious. And in being cautious, it wasn't as freewheeling as it could be. And so, I would sense that. And so it wasn't very funny, even though, you know, it seemed like it maybe was working. I have to laugh. If I'm cracking myself up, and I don't mean that to say, gee, aren't I a genius? If I'm laughing, then I gotta say, well, by God, I must have hit the bullseye tonight, because I'm laughing.
And when did you find that confidence?
The confidence to laugh at, to know that I was good if I laughed.
You're the final judge, jury, and executioner.
Oh yeah. After I would say, you know, David, I spent 17 years as a disc jockey, kind of morning show host kind of a guy. And you know those shows, you know, you're going in and you're trying to be funny. And you even have a joke service. And then you sit down with a program director who tells you how much you sucked that morning. And you go home and you're wondering, why am I doing it? And your entire life is based on, does the boss like me? Does the boss like me? And if you get fired enough times, and in radio, that's what we say. You know, there's people, two kinds of people, either the ones that get fired or the ones that... haven't been fired yet. But you get fired enough times, and you either do one of two things. You get your shit together and figure out how to really do this thing, or you get out of the business and do something else, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I, fortunately, I was the former. I said, well, no, wait just a second here, man. I like doing this, and I know I'm good at it. What? I'm going to take the governor off, and I'm not going to edit as much, and I'm just going to go for it, man, no matter what happens. And that's when you say, I don't care who laughs. I don't care if I get a big audience or a little audience. If I'm speaking my truth, and if I'm doing exactly what I've always wanted to do, then then I'm a success. You know, I mean, I heard an interview with Brian Dennehy. He was an actor. Mm-hmm. Driving a cab in New York, he said, I was making $50 a week driving a cab, and I was doing this Equity Waiver Theater, and I thought I was a success. They said, why? He said, because I was happy. I couldn't have been more happy. He wasn't a movie star. He wasn't even a big theater star. He was making $50 a week driving a cab and working for free in Equity Waiver. And that's always stayed with me, you know, to be successful, you got to really dig it. You got to enjoy it. It's just, you know, like, and if I shake my head some days and I go, God damn it, man, why haven't I won a Marconi Award, you know? I don't want to say it's because the fools don't understand the genius in their midst. I don't want to be like Dr. Frankenstein or anything. There's just a whole lot of other considerations out there that aren't quite making it down to my level yet, but I know I'm doing good stuff, and I have good guys like you and Lori and whoever I've met through the years that I admire and I love and I think are funnier than hell. And the biggest award that I could get would be a guy like you, David, calling me up and saying we'd be on my podcast, or Judd Apatow saying, you want to be in my movie? Or, I mean, I could never in my wildest dreams have thought that would happen to me. So,
well, you know, are operating, and you've been very generous with your time, and I know you have to get your show ready. I wanted to ask you two more questions about intellectual stamina, because you have stamina. I'm always curious where you get that stamina from. How you're able to do it day in and day out without burning out.
Oh, well, you got to make a living, you know. It's as simple as that, you know. And now I own a business, you know. So if I was just working for a radio station, I'd probably quit, take a month off, go here, go there, maybe something like that. But I own this business now, and I have to keep the dollars coming in. And, you know, it's like I always used to hear people who own restaurants, you know, you're there, you're mopping the floor, and you're cooking the food, and you're doing everything. Well, it's true. And with this little business that we have not only the show has to be produced, but we have to make sure that technically we're right. We do fulfillment. We sell merchandise. We are in touch with our advertisers. We are in touch with our subscribers. We're, you know, there's never a minute of the day that I'm not thinking about it. My girlfriend is off on a cruise this week. I would love to be with her, but I can't do it, you know, so.
Right. Well,
I think it's just, you got to do it. Look, you have kids, man. You know, say, well, how do you do it, David? I got kids I got to take care of. Right. You know, I got a family I got to take care of, you know, so you find a way.
Let me tell my listeners that they have to go to philhendryshow.com and sign up. $8-$9 a month. 30,000 hours have been archived. I promise you, you will end up quitting your job, leaving your wife, sitting in your car, immobile. You'll be paralyzed by this man's genius. You know, David Letterman said of Robin Williams, when Robin came on the scene in Los Angeles, all the comics realized that there was Robin Williams and then this other type of comedy that people were doing, that the rest of us were on the ground and Robin was in the stratosphere. And then Robin would go off and do movies, and then the comics could pretend they were funny. And then Robin would return to remind the comics that, yes, we're just mere mortals. The same holds true for Phil Hendrie. This is true. And I hope my listeners will go sign up for philhendryshow.com and start listening to this. You're operating at a completely different level of comedy. And I started listening to you last night, the archives, and my bootlegs of you hold up, because I've listened, you know, I play them for people. But the stuff I was listening to last night, funnier the second time. It not only does it hold up, not only does it hold up, it's at another level of artistry. And thank God that They have been archived and curated.
Yeah.
You've done, whoever did that for you has done such an amazing job to go through the years, and they tell you who the characters are and what the premise is. And I'm pretty much going to go get off the phone with you and go listen to some more stuff. This has been an honor, yeah. and a little terrifying. You must know, no. though, that anybody who does comedy in Los Angeles knows what you are, right? You must know that.
I got a lot of friends. I've made a lot of friends in the stand-up comedy business, and then I'll have somebody like Jennifer Coolidge, who I think's hysterically funny.
Mm-hmm.
And I met her one day at a Napoleon Dynamite voice session. She was playing a character, and she walked in, she looked at me, she goes, "Oh, you're the guy they all think is funny, huh?" And so there's that. I get that reaction right now again. Fortunately, generally the women, no, I wouldn't say that. But, it helped because I was doing once a month. If I'd known you, David, I would have asked you, but I was doing once a month a Phil Hendrie and Friends over the Hollywood Improv. And fortunately, I could call up three or four people and say, would you come up on stage with me? And they would. And I doubt what you guys do. I cannot do. I wish I could. I can't. I can't write jokes. I can't stand there. My timing sucks. The audience gets to me too much. I can stand in front of a camera. I could go on stage and do a play. But stand-up comedy takes so much courage, and I'm not just saying that. After the year was up doing that at the Hollywood Improv, and they said, "You want to do some more?" I said, "I can't. I don't think so, because I don't think I'm any good at it." Man, you know?
Well, it's not even stand up for the most part. Is just this rigidity, this repeating the same bits over and over and honing them. Your mind mm-hmm. is, you're working so fast, and you're so prolific. Why would you bother with stand-up comedy? Your mind is so... anyway, I can't even begin to thank you for the joy that you've brought my family and continue to bring my family and my listeners. Go to philhendrieshow.com. Watch his live show that he does every day and go through those mm-hmm. archives. You will... No commercials. You will be... Mm-hmm. You won't be able to move. You'll be crippled. Thank you so much, Phil. Phil Hendrie, thank you so much.
Thank you, David. Thank you, brother. It was great time. Thank you.